this house of victory. Jesus save, Jesus save.
Amen.
Holy One, save.
Sister Kim, thank you, darling.
Amen.
I was so much in love, I couldn't, I was blind to my
Lord.
You
are.
Mercy on you. Good morning.
Good morning, Lord.
Has it ever seen your prayers are not being answered and you wonder why? Several conditions must be met for our prayers to be effective. First, your prayer must be sincere and your faith true. In Mark 11:24, Jesus said, whatsoever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. He also assures us in Mark 9:23 that all things are possible to him that believeth. Are you praying in Jesus' name? Jesus himself said, and whatsoever you should ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Be sure that your prayers are consistent with and according to the perfect will of God. How will you know His will and His promises are throughout the Scriptures? If you diligently seek to determine His will and pray with confidence and faith, God would answer that prayer. Read the parable of the persistent will, Luke 18:1-7, and know we are to be persistent in prayer. And remember, Paul admonished to be steadfast in prayer. Pray much, pray mightily, and never doubt, for God hears and answers prayer. We thank God for our fourth Sunday fellowship with the residents of Deanwood Care Center and the sacrificial service of the saints to pass on your blessings. Want to know more about Jesus, got questions and need answers, make the sacrifice and join us in Sunday School and Bible Study Prayer Service. Upcoming events, reach out to others now and invite them to our upcoming youth week and Vacation Bible School. Prepare now for our June church meeting. Please check our website for specific dates and times at njbcmd.org. Keep in prayer and in mind. Pray for our sick, shut-in, traveling, and bereaved families, our young people at home and away, those in need of His protection, a covering, peace, and healing, for all who have said, pray for me. Weekly reminders, join us each Wednesday at 7 p.m. for Bible study, prayer service, Sunday school each Sunday morning at 9:30 a.m. And don't forget your Bible verse for Sunday school. And third Saturday, men's fellowship at 10 a.m. Each second Saturday at noon, women's ministry. Our Deanwood Care Center fellowship is each fourth Sunday at 2:30 p.m. Need a ride to church Sunday. Minister Campbell will not be here Sunday. So somebody else's name has to be on there if they need a ride. Continue to pray for and support our church website at njbc.org. We're also now on Twitter at New Jerusalem, D.C., Google Plus, Yahoo, YouTube, and Facebook. Tell a friend about this wonderful outreach endeavor that they too can be blessed. Visitors are always welcome at New Jerusalem Baptist Church. God loves you and so do we. Thoughts of the week. Some think that since God knows our future and the choices we will make, then we don't really have the gift of free will. They believe if God knows we are going to make a certain choice, then we're not really free to make a different choice. But think about it this way. If we listen to the weather report and then say, the sun will rise tomorrow, we're not causing the sun to rise, nor are we preventing it from rising by just knowing that it would happen. Or if we give a child the choice of a bowl of ice cream and a bowl of cauliflower, we know both, and not all children, if allowed free will, free choice, would choose the ice cream. Our knowing ahead of time their life of choice does not restrict the child from making a free will choice. One of the greatest daily gifts Jesus gives us is our ability to choose. We can choose salvation or damnation. If we follow His word, we can choose to be content or discontent in the state we are in. We can choose to be in a good mood or a bad mood daily. We can worry for tomorrow, or we can put our faith and trust in God. We can allow others and their ungodly actions to ruin our days, or we can draw on the joy and hope that is in Jesus. We can choose to see an unfortunate situation as the end of our lives, or we can ask God to step in and take control and renew I guess our faith. I don't know what the last line is. Thank you. This is our prayer list. The Burke family, Campbell family, Donna Burton, Alicia Thomas, Melanie Webb and family, Charles White, Doris Gordon, Kobe White, Kayla White, Deja White, Jarish Jr., White Jr., Sister Frey Rogers and family, Jenkins family, Clark family, Hare family, Boyd family, Harris family, and Delphine.
Good morning, New Jerusalem.
Good morning.
Thank you, Sister Campbell, for the reading of our announcements. And certainly we thank God for allowing us to be here on this, another large day. On last week, we normally had our birthday club announcements, and for whatever reason, overlooked it. And so this week, we're going to try and make up by asking all of our members of the April, not May, but the April Birthday Club. We realize this is May the 1st. All members of the April Birthday Club, if they will please stand up, that we might see who you are. And we got a few of them here, so we're going to ask each of you to tell us when your birthday is, and if you want to, you can tell us what your age is, and I will show you how easy it is. Deja, tell us what your birthday is and how old you are.
Okay, so we were born on April 14th, and we just turned 17.
Oh, wow. Deja and Kobe are twins. Amen. Praise the Lord. Baby, we see this thing. See how easy that was? So Sister Dorothy, go ahead. Why don't you?
I'm April 29th, and I am 17.
Amen. All right, now bless the Lord. Nick.
April 8th,
47. All right. Praise the Lord. So we got all the generations coming here today. We got the seniors, we got the in between, and we got the young people. So New Jerusalem is well represented here this morning. So let us all say, instead of saying happy birthday, let's say amen.
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 Amen. Amen. And Minister White's going to lead us in a chorus of happy birthday. Show up at Eleanor Roosevelt High School on Green Belt Road. I think 6 o'clock is the time that they get started.
After 6:30.
Between 6 and 6:30, need to get there a little early on the first day to pick up your information and your badges. And it should all be there. Now, because we have an education conference on next week, we will not be having Bible study. We will be having prayer service starting at 7 o'clock. And Minister Campbell, I took liberty to say that since you were not one of the people registered for a class, that you would be here to, you won't be in time. Okay. So, Brother Bryce, did you register for a class?
No, I haven't registered
yet. Okay, so you're going to be here to lead the prayer service on Wednesday night starting at 7 o'clock. Can I depend on you to do that?
Yes, sir, you can.
Okay, now we have it. So, those of you who are not registered for classes and would wish to come out to prayer service on Wednesday, Deacon Bridge will be here to guide us in for prayer service. That's all that I have. We have meeting announcements. Been talking to Sister Henderson every day this week. She's come along just fine. My dear's doing fine. And Sister Henderson is scheduled to be back in town this coming Friday. And not Friday, but Saturday evening. So she may or may not be here in church on next Sunday, depending on how well that Saturday evening goes. But be in prayer for her. She's been holding up pretty well. They've been having some of the same kind of weather there that we have here. And it's kind of leaving everybody a little bit of a haul, I guess is the best way that I can put it. But I've been enjoying it because it's given me some downtime, and I've been taking full advantage of it. Amen. That's all I have for now in the way of the announcement. She did read off our prayer list already, so I won't do that again. I just say, let us please continue to pray one for another. Okay, at this time, I'm going to turn to our choir bus selection, but before we do that, we want to acknowledge our visitors and also to acknowledge the fact that this week we received in the mail an offering from the Sister Dorothy Robinson, Deaconess Dorothy Robinson of Bethesda Baptist Church. She sent us a gift of $100. And so, Sister Green, could you send a thank you note for me? Mr. Gamble will have the envelope with her. She's coming to get it now. And she doesn't trust you.
Amen.
So, at this time, we're going to look to our choir. I'm over 50.
You're over 70.
I got you. We said, Minister, what?
You're over 70.
Oh. Well, since you're older than me. Okay, but we want to acknowledge our visitors, and I understand that we do have some visitors with us this morning. I don't know if I understand. I can look around. I can see very well we have some visitors with us other than Kayla and Kobe. We know about them. But we have one of them today. If you will please stand so that we might see you and that we might reach you. Tell us what your name is, what church you're a member of, if you so desire. If not, you may be seated. We don't require it. Just want to let you know that we do acknowledge you and we welcome you to our service this morning.
I'm Latia Thomas, and I'm a member of the church. And your name is my sister.
And your?
That's Tia. She joined the church, but she just hasn't been here. She's in a wild
place.
That's
what's her name?
Tia. My sister.
Oh. Okay. Oh. Yeah. Oh. No, I good. how time flies.
She doesn't remember this.
Well, so happy to have you here with us this morning,
yes,
Saint.
Thank you.
And I guess you indicated that you're not a member of the church, Saint. You're saying you haven't been to church in a while.
Yes.
Amen. And yes. So, if you're ready to get your life back in order, when we open the doors of the church this morning, you're going to come up and you're going to renew your fellowship with New Jerusalem Baptist Church.
Amen.
And, Lord,
come on,
and your sister said so. I am saying that just in a way of confidence, is that I'm not telling you to have to do that, but it is a good thing.
Yes.
And
I think
you're here today because you want to get this life back in order.
Yes.
And now today, seize the day, say.
Yes.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're going to look at choir.
Save my soul. God is good.
Money in my pocket.
God is good.
Cheerful giving. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Maketh me to lie down between pastures. Leadeth me beside still waters. Restoreth my soul. Leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemy. Thou anointest my head with oil. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's all stand. As one of our officers leads us in our auditorium prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this part of the Lord. We wish we could bless those that gave, the ones that gave, but had their hearts in mind. And our Lord, bless us, we ask in your precious Son's name, for the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
All thanks. Washington Baptist Seminary is having its baccalaureate service today at 3 o'clock. And it's going to be held at the Word of God Baptist Church. Support to the Washington Baptist Seminary today at 3 o'clock. It's going to be held at the Word of God Baptist Church. Minister Charles Bynum, Cornerstone Baptist Church, will be bringing the message. This morning, we want to turn our attention to the book of Philippians, Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to read starting at the first verse of the second chapter of the book of Philippians, Philippians chapter 2, verse 1, and we're going to read down through verse 11. Philippians chapter 2, we have started at verse 1. Still here, a few pages turning. I'll carry a while longer as you turn to it in your Bibles. Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. And we're going to move on. If there be, therefore, any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any vows and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. So into the reading, may God bless the reader and the hearers of God's word. This morning, for a brief moment, we want to focus our attention on that ninth verse, which I'll read again for the hearing. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Using for a subject this morning, there is no compromise in the name of Jesus. There is no compromise in the name of Jesus. Too many of us in the world, the times in which we live, think that we are so smart. We know everything. And so compassionate toward mankind and for our fellow man that we call ourselves showing our compassion by making statements like, I don't believe that God would let a good person go to hell. And we think we're something when we say something like that. We think we're being kind to other people when we say things like that. we say things like, it doesn't matter what God we believe in, as long as we believe there is a God. And we think we smart, we think we intelligent. We say stuff like that, and we're being kind to our sisters and brothers. We say things like, there has got to be more than one way to get to heaven. More than one way to skin a cat. We think we're smart. We think we're intelligent when we say things like that. And we say it with such conviction. We say it so smooth that people hear us saying it. And we, the people listen and say, oh, yeah, man, you're right. Amen, amen, amen. I come to remind you, there's no compromise in the name of Jesus. We've come so smart, we say things like, as long as the good in our life outweighs the bad, God will have mercy upon us. Long as the good in our life outweigh the bad. Well, I hope you got some good skills. Because I tell you, I don't know too many that can truly say that the good in their lives outweigh the bad. I'm going to leave that alone. You're going to trust yourself with that kind of thinking. Lord, have mercy upon you. But I'm here to tell you that even if the good in your life outweighs the bad, we cannot, we must not, we will not compromise the name of Jesus. We say things like, can't no one else pay for another man's sin? How in the world do you think that Jesus dying on the cross will pay for your sins? Everybody got to pay for their own sins. Can't nobody else pay for your sins. Well, how do you plan to get to heaven? If you, no one else can pay for your sins, and you can't pay for them yourself, how do you plan to get to heaven? In the book I've been reading called Jesus, Jihad, and Peace by author Michael Youssef, he talks about the talk show host Oprah Winfrey, who once interviewed a woman who claimed to have had a near-death experience. The woman said she died, left her body, and encountered Jesus. She told Oprah that while she was dead, Jesus revealed to her that all religions are equally true. Jesus revealed that to her when she died.
Okay.
Oprah replied, I believe that there are many paths to God, or many paths to the light. I certainly don't believe that there is only one way. Did Jesus indicate that to you? She asked the woman. The woman said, yes. Absolutely. Well, Oprah said, I'm glad to hear that, because if Jesus is as cool as I think he is, he would have to have told you that. Just to give you some indication of how confused our world is, how people who claim to be Christians are so unsound in their doctrine, so unsound in their belief. Why would Jesus tell you that all religions are true? Why would Jesus tell you that there are other ways to get to heaven and make himself a lie? For the Bible tells us that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Yes.
no man cometh to the Father but by me.
Yes, all right.
But for whatever reason, we in our own super intelligence want to believe that we got this thing figured out. We haven't come to the realization that our ways are not his ways, our thoughts are not his thoughts. We haven't come to the conclusion that the intelligence of man is but foolishness in the sight of God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. And that there is no compromise, none, no compromise in the name of Jesus. For God says, I have given him a name, and I have highly exalted him, given him a name which is above every name.
That's right.
We keep fooling ourselves into believing that the name of Jesus is not all of that. So my sisters and brothers, I'm here once again, as I have for so many times in the past, to remind you that there is no other name by which you can be saved. And the great tragedy of our time is that at least, and hear what I say, 25% of the people in our churches, not in the world, at least 25% of the people in our churches openly profess that they believe that there are other ways to get to heaven. Mm-hmm. Oh, I got some Jehovah Witness friends, and they're real nice people. I don't believe God will let them go to hell. My mother was Jehovah Witness, and my father, he was a Muslim, and he was a good man. I don't believe that God go let my good father go to hell. My father sent me to college and raised me up real good. I don't believe that God's gonna let them go to hell. Well, God isn't letting anybody go to hell.
That's right.
But what God has done, he's made a way out of no way. What he has done is that he so loved us that while we were yet sinners, that he gave his son Jesus to die on Calvary's cross for our sins. How shall we be saved if we neglect so great a salvation?
Yes.
We have a problem understanding just how deep and how serious this thing sin is. We have a problem understanding that the original sin and the original sin that Adam and Eve sinned was passed on to all of us. And so all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And that there's nothing that God hates worse than sin.
Yes,
he hates sin so much that he when he put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, he said, if you disobey me, I'm going to kill you. I don't want you to die. I want you to live forever. I'll give you anything that you want. I'll give you anything that you need. And if you see something that you want that's not out, all you got to do is ask me and I'll give that to you too.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Only one thing I ask you to do, there's a tree that's in the midst of the garden, that is a tree of knowledge and of good and evil. Don't you eat of that tree. Because if you disobey me to that tree, I'm going to kill you. Because you're not able to endure the consequences of eating of that tree. If you obey me, you can live life forever.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. No sickness, no sorrow, nothing but joy and happiness. Therefore, God hates sin. You mean I offered you eternal? eternal bliss, eternal happiness. And all I asked you to do was obey this one thing. And you were so full of yourself. You were so full of pride. You were so self-absorbed that you had to do it your way. Therefore, God hates sin, and therefore, he couldn't go back on his word. He says, in the day that you eat of that tree, I'm not going to compromise my holiness. I'm not going to compromise my righteousness. I'm not going to allow sin to spread. The day you eat of that tree, you're going to surely die. I'm gonna kill you. And guess what? If God say he's gonna kill you, what you gonna do? Bad boy, what you gonna do? No place to hide. The soul that sinned shall die. And so all of us were on our way to hell. All of us were condemned to hell, and there was no escaping. Because all had sinned and come short of the glory of God.
All right, man.
But God so loved us. Realizing that we couldn't save ourselves, we so loved us. The Apostle Paul said, when I would do good, I'm trying to do right, Lord. But when I would do good, evil is always present. Help me.
Yes.
God gave his law to us to help us along the way to know what sin is. And he told us what sin was, and he wrote it in black and white and made it plain. He said, now if you do these things, if you keep my holy law,
yes,
then repent of your sin, then I will not condemn you to hell. But guess what? There was no one that was able to keep the law of God. Not just the Ten Commandments, but you can use the Ten Commandments, and every one of us in here this morning is condemned. Remember the Lord thy God, thou shalt have no other God before him. Shucks, we so stupid, we put the NFL before God. The saying goes, and it's pretty close to true, that the churches used to rule Sunday morning, but the NFL rules Sunday morning now. And they've got to kill a hole. And so all have sinned and come short. When I would do good, evil was always present, so we all were condemned to hell. There was nothing we could do. There are some folks who reject the Bible and say, that can't be true. There must be a way. They say it can't be true. They say that if I do this and I do that, and I do these things that I believe are pleasing in the sight of God, that I believe that God, when I die, will have mercy on me, because the good I do will outweigh the bad.
Mm. All right, now.
Every morning when I wake up, my very thoughts are sinful. Every morning when I wake up, I need to get down on my knees and love. Say, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. And I have the gift of the Holy Spirit on the inside me that helps me to overcome wrong. Can you imagine those who don't have the Holy Spirit?
Have mercy.
And some of them manage to look pretty good on the outside. Oh, but on the inside, Jesus, when he said of the Pharisees, says, on the outside, you're just as pristine and white as you can be. On the outside, you just appear to be as righteous. When you're in the public, you walk right and you talk right. When you're in the public, all but with you behind closed doors. When you're behind closed doors and you think that people are not looking, all those lustful thoughts, all those evil deeds that you had in your mind, when you're behind closed doors and you turn on that television and you land on one of those pornographic stations and you flash by it real quick and it caught your eye and you find yourself flipping back to it, was that what I really thought it was? And then after you say, yeah, it's what you really thought it was, and just turn it away and say, yeah. Ain't nobody around.
Lord Jesus.
Ain't nobody looking. Y'all know I'm right, don't I? And if we don't put our trust in Lord, if we don't ask the Lord, created me a clean heart, Lord, lead me. We gonna keep looking at that station. And if we keep looking at that station, when lust is conceived, it bringeth forth sin.
Yes. All right, now.
You're not only going to want to look at that kind of activity, you're going to want to indulge in that kind of activity. One of the biggest problems of our world today that we've got so many problems with sex and homosexuality that because we have become so promiscuous with sex that normal sex don't feel good anymore. I'm listening to a radio station, one of the sports radio stations just the other day, and well-known sports figure said, yeah, when I was in college, a married couple of mine asked me if I wanted to engage in a threesome with them. Bless his heart, he said, it scared me so I ran home. Another talk to a host said, you mean you didn't take him up on it? I said, Lord Jesus. We've gotten to the point in our life that because we defiled the sanctity of marriage, because we defiled God's intention for sex, that we have just totally gone off the charts. And then there's no fun in sex anymore. And as it becomes no fun in sex anymore, we find ourselves doing perverted things. Because we refuse to obey God, because we exchange the truth for a lie, Bible said God gave us up to our reprobate mind. You think what's going on today just started happening and that God didn't know it was going to happen if you didn't obey his word? He said that, and because they would not acknowledge God as God, God gave them up, and men started doing with men that which is unseemly. Women started doing with women that which is against nature. Because we refuse to acknowledge the power of sin, the consequences of sin. And so now we're in the predicament today that we have gotten so far off base that we call wrong right. I'll put you in jail. I'll take you to court. I have you sued for telling me that I can't live the way I want to live. I don't care what God says. Amen. liar.
Amen, amen, amen.
They had to call Jesus a liar. And then you go say, God made you this way? In the beginning, God created man in his own image. Male and female created he them, period.
Amen.
So now, we're saying that God made us this way. So that opened the way for folks who are pedophiles saying that, well, I've been this way all my life. I just got this feeling that I can't control, and I was raised in an environment where I was abused as a child, and this feeling I just can't control it, and God made me this way. So you can't really put me in jail. Look how I was raised, and look what I had to go through, and I don't have no control over myself. You gotta have mercy on me. What I need is some counseling. What I need is to see a psychiatrist. No, what you need is to turn away from sin. What you need is Jesus.
I know.
So we've glossed over our immorality by saying that, oh, we are victims of our environment. There's no compromise, my sisters and brothers, in the name of Jesus. So here again is why there's no other name. There's no other name, my sisters and brothers, because Jesus is God.
Yes.
Jesus is God. Amen. Other religions frown upon us and look down upon us and say, oh, Christians are polytheists. Polytheists meaning that they believe in many gods. They believe in God Jesus. They believe in God. Well, we know it's God the Holy Ghost. Some of them think that the Trinity is God the Father, God the Son, and Mary. Holy Mother Mary. When they speak of the Trinity, they think that we're talking about God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, and Mary. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Three persons, yet one God. We never said that we were worshiping more than one God. And so they say that all those Christians, they're polytheists. And because they're polytheists, we look down upon them. The Lord our God, the Jews say, is one God. We believe in Allah alone, and if anybody believes in anything else, then it is worshiping idol gods. So Christians, if they worship more than one God, then they believe in polytheism, God the Father, but good, Jesus is God. And God so loved us that he came to redeem us from our sins.
Yes.
I've been talking a lot more than I had planned to talk about this morning. That we had gotten so sunk in our sins. We are so mired in sin today that there was no way for us to save ourselves. Because we rejected the knowledge of God, God has given up on us. Not only us in the world, it's almost like he's given up on the church. Because we've got as many problems in the church as we got in the world. The reason why we got problems in the world is because we got problems in the church. And if we in the church would go and do what God commanded us to do, go ye therefore and let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. But instead of letting our light shine, we spend our time trying to become more like the world. Your children ain't gonna come to church if we don't let them have rap singing. They're not gonna come to church if we don't let them dress any way that they want. They're not gonna come to church if we don't have church at the time that they want. Did you ever think you see the day that you couldn't go to any church and you want to at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning and service would be starting? You mess around and go to these churches today at 11 o'clock. And you may or may not find church going on. If you go to church today looking for a Sunday school, you may find in most cases that they have to eliminate Sunday school so they can have more services, and they got to have more services so that they can get more people in the church, and they got to have more people in the church so they can take up more offerings, and they got to take up more offerings because they got to pay for that big building. So they have 9 o'clock service, they have 7 o'clock service, 9 o'clock service, 11 o'clock service, 2 o'clock service. And the thing that they are most trained at is how to get traffic in and out. And Officer White, they have put off miles. They have called on the police to help them out with it. Y'all come over here. Help me get these people out of here and get some more people in here. Business time of the week and for officers is when they're trying to get people in and out of them services. Big churches. And every morning I'm coming to church, they hold me up from getting to church so they can get them other people out of church. Right, right. Say something wrong with this.
Right. Yes, yes.
That's the Lord, maybe something good is gonna come out of that. Certainly I'm not saying that the big church in itself is wrong. I'm just saying that we've got to be a little bit more mindful of what our motive is for building the big churches. And it seems as though the only people that are benefiting from the big churches is the folks who are building them and the millions of dollars they get. Pepco loves it because every time they cut them power switches on, they get just money unlimited. Everybody's loving it for the money that's being spent on this big church. I was just in a meeting this past week where they said the church right down the street here, I don't know the name, but it says it's costing them $25 million. $25 million to build that church. Was it not, Lord? $25 million to build a church. And the construction, this was the construction worker talking to me, and he was just as happy as he could be.
He didn't like that kid, right?
I believe that. But Jesus is God, and he so loved us that he came down to redeem us. Secondly, God made himself a man while still being God so that he could become sin, listen to me, become sin for us, and by doing so, he did not violate his divine law. For the law said, the soul that sinneth shall die. And though we may deny it, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There was no way for us to be redeemed.
All of us had come short. All of us were on our way to hell, and God had such love and compassion toward us that he made himself a body, took on the form of a man, died to pay for our sins.
Yes.
And therefore, we can be delivered and saved from what we could not do for ourselves. He did not use his godly powers to secure our salvation. He had a body just like we have. When you pricked him, he bleed. When you didn't feed him, he got hungry like anyone else. He had need like anyone else. Scripture said foxes had holes and the birds of the air had nests, but he didn't have a place to lay his head, so he knew what the homeless people felt like. He knew what the hungry people felt like. He was totally dependent upon others to give him sustenance for his existence, and he was God.
Yes.
He could have spoke when Satan tempted him in the wilderness, and Satan tempted him with bread, saying, "Why don't you? I know you're hungry. He hadn't eaten for 40 days. Have some of this bread." And man, I don't know about you, but when you're hungry and you taste bread, even with no butter on it, it tastes so good.
Yes.
Woo, that man, you taste all the ingredients in it. And so Satan said, have some of this bread. But Jesus reminded Satan that, and remind us that he did it to set the example for us to live by. And he said, Satan, get thee behind me. Man shall not live by bread alone.
Yes.
If you want to live, you got to live by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. And his lesson to us was not that we should starve ourselves, but we should not choose food over God. If you got to deny God, if you got to bow down to Satan for a little bit of food, that's not a good deal. That's a bad deal.
Yeah.
Religion was something that money could buy. The rich would live and the poor would die. He didn't use his godly powers to secure our salvation, but he humbled himself and took on the form of sinful man, yet without sin, and died on the cross to pay for our sins. I'm bringing to an end, saints. But because he was God, because he was fully righteous, death had no dominion over him. So he could give his life. And though he could give his life, and because the wages of sin was death, because he knew no sin, because he was righteous, when he went down to the grave had no power over him. Therefore, he had the power to give his life, and he had the power to pick it up again. And the wonderful thing about that, he was fully man. But while he fully man, he was fully God. And because he was fully God, he was fully holy. And he was fully righteousness. Oh, death, where is thy sting? And he got up from the grave with all power and heaven and earth in his hands. And he said, anyone, listen to me. He says, anyone, as many as believe on the Lord Jesus, they shall be saved.
Yes, yes.
For if you will confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus, that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For there is no other name, no other name, none other name given among men by which we shall be saved. But preacher, what about Allah? Well, I don't know about Allah. I read my Bible from Genesis to Revelation, and I haven't seen Allah in here one time.
Amen.
never pass away. Because it's been inspired by God. I believe it's the word of God because I read it and I followed the instructions, Sister Burgess. And when I followed the instructions, when I did the things that God commanded me to do, I received the blessing that God had in store for me. He said, believe on the Lord Jesus, and I will save your soul. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye are weak and heavy laden, and I will give rest unto your soul. For my yoke is easy, and my burden of life, and I was weighed down in a world of sin and shame. I was so weighed down that I was almost down to the ground. Sin had a death grip on me, and I came to Jesus. Hey, as I was weary. Oh yes, I was weary. Jesus said, come unto me, all you who are weary. I was weary. Oh, I wasn't weary because of my bills. I wasn't weary because of my job. I was weary because of sin. I was weary because I was a wreck. I was weary because I wanted a better way.
Yes.
I heard Jesus say, come unto me. If you're weary and you're tired of sin in your life, come unto me and take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy. And as many as believed on the name Jesus, God gave them the power to become the children of God. And so now I can say, he changed my walk so I can walk right. He changed my talk so I can talk right. Oh, he changed my mindset that now I can praise him. Now I can uplift this good. I can call on the name of Jesus and not be ashamed. Yes. I can tell the world that Jesus is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life without hesitating about it. I can tell the world, yeah, you might believe in another God, but it will never get you to heaven. Because there's only one way.
Yes.
And that only one way is Jesus. He is the way. Now, I'm not telling you what I think. I'm telling you what I know.
Yes.
How do I know it? I read it in God's word. That's how I know it.
Yes.
Tell me how you know it. I know it because I tried it for myself.
Yes.
And there's something within me. I was a wretch, y'all. Oh, yes, I was. And I've been changed.
Yes.
And I know that there's nothing but the power of God through the name of Jesus. That I've been changed.
Yes.
I'm bringing to a close. I remember when I was a kid that when my older siblings would tell me to do something, I might do it, might not do it. But when they said, Mama said to do something, oh, that was a different story. Because if I don't do what Mama said, oh, when Mama came home, there were some consequences. And if I don't do it when Mama said, and I didn't quite experience, but y'all know what I'm talking about, and Mama told Daddy, I told that boy to do that, Daddy, and he didn't do it, oh, we were showing up in trouble. Well, I'm here to tell you that God said, he has given Jesus a name which is above every name. God said, and at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow.
Yes.
At the name of Jesus, every tongue should confess of things in heaven and things in earth and things beneath the earth. There's no other name, my sisters and brothers. And he cannot tell a lie. He has declared that he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life.
Yes.
No man cometh to the Father but by me. There is no compromise. No need you apologizing to your friends,
your Muslim friend, Jehovah Witness friend, your Jewish friends, whatever friends, any friend that's dependent on something other than Jesus, let them know that there's no other way. Let them know that there's no other name. Don't stutter when you say it. Don't hesitate when you say it. But let them know that Jesus and Jesus alone, he is the way. He is the life. They may hate you for it, but that's okay. They hated Jesus.
Amen.
But the good thing about them hating, boy, they might even take your life. You might have to suffer for it. Oh, but Jesus said this too in response to that. He said, if any man would try to save his life and go along with the program, what did Jesus say gonna happen? Anybody try to save his life, he's gonna lose it. But if any man will lose his life for my sake, you shall have life everlasting. There's no escaping, my sisters and brothers. If you want to be saved, there's only one way that you can be saved. It's not by the name of Buddha. It's not by the name of Hare Krishna. It's not by the name of Confucius. It's not by the name of Allah. But at the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Every knee.
Yes.
Shall bow. And every knee's going to bow because his daddy, Jehovah Jireh. His daddy, yes. Jehovah Nisi, the Lord of my banner.
Yes.
His daddy, the yes. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. His daddy, Jehovah Sabbath, the Lord of hosts. His daddy is Jehovah Shalom, the Lord of priests. Yes. His daddy, El Shaddai. His daddy, Elyon. His daddy, El Erlan. He said, you're going to bow.
Yes. Hallelujah.
God said, that's selfish.
Thank you.
It's all right with me. Thank God for Jesus. Let us all stand as we join in our invitation.